welcome you heartily in the name of Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd. We are one flock in his worldwide fold. We try to hear his voice and obey his commandments. We are thankful that he knows each of us by name. He gave his life for his sheep, for you and for me, and for the entire world.
Amen.
Does anyone have any announcements?
We had a registration today.
I heard there were 10 people there.
Yes.
That's great.
Thank you. doing, Sue? Okay, turn around. Greet people that you've not seen. Good. All right, good. Greet one another. And now you may be seated for our invocation.
In your bulletin, the invocation, which we will read and use. Father, we seek thy truth. Lest we be deceived and misled. We seek thy love. Lest we go unloving and uncaring through the day.
We seek thy peace. Lest we waste our time and anxieties that eat up our energies and profit neither ourselves nor others. We seek thyself.
Thank you. weeks later they'll do my right hand. So I'm really anxious for the surgery. If they could have done it this week, I would have had it done. So please keep me in your prayers. Anyone else? June.
I give thanks for answered prayer for Robbie.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. June gives thanks for answered prayers for Robbie. We were all concerned. Anyone else? Okay, thank you.
Take your individual needs to God in prayer. God is a good God all the time, is he not? Amen?
Amen.
He does hear and answer our prayers. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this good day, the day the Lord hath made, and we will be glad and rejoice in it. We give you thanks. You're worthy of all thanks and praise. Yes, we thank you for being with Robbie during his surgery. Thank you that he is even here today to give you thanks and praise for taking him through that surgery. Pray for Karen. Pray for Mike in their particular need right now. Be with them as they have just met so many situations all at once.
You are the God that hears and answers our prayers. Pray for God's son. Thank you for his visit. And again, as he takes his flight, be with him as he returns home. Our hearts go out for those in Haiti, another tragedy, so many deaths that have occurred. We pray for that country, for the unrest, for people that are homeless and have lost everything. Father, we pray for Kathy as she faces surgery in her hand. Hands be with her, Lord, and may all be well in that surgery. Lord, I pray that you bless your word today, that you will again speak to us through the living word of God. Teach us to pray as you taught your disciples, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Again to this very important time in our service, and it's another opportunity for us to say thank you to the Lord for his love and care and his goodness. So keep these things in mind, and as you give your gifts this morning, pray to the Lord that God might use us all and use these gifts His greater glory, in the name of Jesus. gives to you a token, just a small token of our devotion and our commitment to you. Pray that you will use us to your greater glory. Use these gifts to touch lives and to help to change our world. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Inspired.
was Enos, and Linus, and Lucy. One day, Linus came home with his report card. He put it on the table. And so, as sisters will do, if you don't have a sister, well, you're lucky, but no, not really. I have one sister and two brothers. She being the outside, being the oldest. So, Lucy looked at his report card, said to him, "Now, why did you only get a C in history?" And of course, Linus had to defend himself. That's only average. "So what?" he said. "I'm an average student. In an average school, in an average community. So what's wrong with being average? If you grew up in my house and you had the ability to not be average, you certainly were expected to live up to that which you were capable of doing. But here was the word of a very concerned sister. And Lucy said, because you are capable of doing much better." How many of us settle for just being average? And I want to talk to you today, and that's the title of our message. And I want you to listen because we have someone in the scripture that was very, very average, but did extraordinary things in spite of his being average. The average Christian will attend more than 1,600 church services in their lifetime, hear more than 2,000 sermons, sing over 20,000 hymns and worship choruses, and still be ordinary or average. And the question that you need to take home with you today and think about, not only in this message, but share with your neighbor, your family: are you just an ordinary or average Christian? Or are you capable of doing better? I mean, how I wish there was a full church here today to hear that. Amen. Yeah. If you are looking via streaming that we make capable here, I hope you're hearing what we're saying. Are you just an ordinary or average Christian? Or are you capable of doing better? Now, what do I mean by ordinary people? Every one of you sitting in front of me today, you come into that category. Because I mean by ordinary people with imperfections. Anybody perfect here? Raise your hand. Okay. Your hand, because I want to shake your hand and never let it go. That's what we mean by ordinary people. Human beings with imperfections, limitations. We don't possess any magical powers. We can't count the stars in the sky. But God calls them each by name. We can't prevent our hair from falling out. Don't you wish? Especially when you look down at the shower, Bob, and you see that hair down there. And you want to That has already been determined. God knows, because he is omniscient, when that day will come. He knows the year, he knows the month, he knows the day, he knows the date. And you cannot do anything about changing that, because he has determined that. Ordinary people, we're prone to illness, physical, mental. We're created a little lower than the angels. We are not perfect. We do make mistakes. Yes, let's call them. Sometimes we do sin. We do have a tendency to be stubborn and rebel. Ask any wife about that, okay? Right? We do. And sometimes we are unthankful. We do have problems at home, on our jobs. We are ordinary. God created us like that. Let's look at an ordinary person who did extraordinary things in Scripture. Moses, the greatest deliverer, I believe, was ordinary. He was human. But yet he did extraordinary things. God used Moses in a miraculous way. Just go through and study how God used Moses as he came face to face with those magicians. When God told Moses to do the same thing, and the river turned to blood, that was done by magic, but intervention, it happened when Moses was commanded to do that. God used Moses to bring his captive children, children of Israel. You know how many years they were captive? 430 years they were slaves. God used Moses when God brought him up into the mountain and gave him the Decalogue, commonly known as the Ten Commandments. See? And God used Moses to institute worship through the tabernacle. Read that in the book of Leviticus. And the Levitical priesthood. God used Moses to demonstrate his omnipotent power. But Moses was ordinary. Moses did not appreciate the gravity of his assignment. And what was that assignment? This was on the burning bush encounter that God speaks to Moses. And here in the land of Midian, remember we talked about Midian and the Midianites. And so, God said to Moses, I want you to deliver my people out of the controlling hand of a brutal Pharaoh and Egyptian bondage. And he said, it's time for the people that have been under slavery to enjoy freedom and a land flowing with milk and honey, a place that rightfully they deserve. And you, again, and the text, you can read. Come now, see? And I will send you to Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel. God chose an ordinary person for this assignment. And God chooses ordinary people today, see, to again
that which he can only use you to do. This was an awesome assignment to stand against sin and evil and world power. And so, again, God said to Moses, an ordinary person, you look at his life, here's the order. You're to bring my people out of Egypt. You're to bring them out of captivity. They are to be released finally from the cruelty and the injustice and the humiliation and the torment. They're to come out of that. See? They're to come out of that life whereby they had to make the bricks under such duress to build the Egyptian pyramids that still stand today. See? And they are to be planted in a new land. Land near the Jordan to enjoy. So that was the assignment. But now look, let's look at the ordinariness, if you will, of Moses. When that assignment was given to Moses, which was an awesome assignment to show you how ordinary Moses was, he did what you, what me, what anyone else would do. He began to make some excuses. Have you ever done that? God tells you to do something. You begin to make excuses. What was his first excuse? In the text, if you read it further, Moses said, "Who am I? I'm not a CEO." That's the first thing Moses said. Who am I? Moses recognized his insufficiency. See? Maybe a little bit like Linus. Only go Satan. See, who am I? And then, because that was the excuse he gave, he made a second excuse. God said, "What is your name?" And Moses again made an excuse. And this was an excuse of ignorance and a lack of experience. Moses was saying, "How can I lead?" And remember, the children of Israel, they were not just 100 or 200 or 300. They had become a nation, see. So that was another excuse. You heard the answer that God said. You simply say, "I am that I am." Have you ever made excuses? Personal illustration. When the good Lord, I gave it to you before, when the good Lord told us that we were to move on from a very, very wonderful assignment that we were enjoying to go up to the area in North Jersey, right outside of Newark. I made all kinds of excuses. I said, "Dear Lord, am I hearing right? How can I follow a man that has been the pastor of this church for 75 years? How would you like to do that, Bob? To be the second pastor in the history of the church?" And the church had fallen, and the church was ready to close, and I can still hear my area minister say, "There are very few Baptists
Italian, number one, that speak Italian, that could be good or bad, right? And for me, it was good for the situation. And again, I made all kinds of excuses. Dear Lord,
even if we
say you've tried and failed. God says that's just the problem. You tried and failed. You thought you could do it on your own. We can do nothing of ourselves. It's only as God helps us and gives us the strength to do it. And so, all of these excuses that Moses gave were totally, totally annihilated and could not be used. The people of Israel needed to see Moses as a man, in spite of his faults, in spite of his weaknesses. First and foremost, they needed to see him as a leader who was devoted to God, and let me put it right, words have, a man that practiced what he preached. Devoted to God, no matter what, no matter where, no matter how, that he was going follow totally and completely. And as Christians, people, listen, church, I speak because of my love for you. As a church, as Christians, people need to see our devotion to God. They need to see God at work in our lives. I get so thrilled as I get to know you, to hear these wonderful testimonies. I've been a member for 50 years of this church and I'm still here. Can you say amen? See, I've been a member all of these years. That's the faithfulness of our God. Can you say amen? See?
Let me tell you something.
It's not the most able who are blessed. It is those who are dedicated and faithful and who trust God. God uses ordinary people in extraordinary ways. And this ordinary day can become an extraordinary day. All you have to do is say, "Here am I, Lord. I'm yours. I'm not going to make any excuses. I don't have any. I'm going to depend on you 24/7. And if that's your prayer and desire, can you say amen, church? Amen? I'm just ordinary. And that's all that God expects. See? A commitment. A commitment to serve Him. No matter what, no matter where, no matter how, to make Him first. To be faithful, to be dedicated, to know that beyond the shadow of a doubt, that in every circumstance and situation, He has been faithful. He will continue to be faithful. All I need to do is trust Him, because He will never leave nor forsake me. If you believe the word of God, can you say amen today, church? Amen. And may this ordinary day become an extraordinary day in your life today, tomorrow, next month, 6 months from now, next year. Because Jesus Christ is the same, hallelujah, yesterday, today, and forever. We serve a great God, church, amen. And He takes the foolish things. We make mistakes, we sin. We do things. He takes, the scripture says, the foolish things of this world. Transforms them to those things that can be redound for His honor and for His glory. Take the word, my Father, and my prayer is that it will have fallen on good soil. Thank you for the promise. We thank you for the illustration in your word of Moses. We thank you today that you do exactly what you say. God uses ordinary people for extraordinary things. To this end, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Stand together and sing, "Channels Only, Blessed Savior." You can look at the screen, it is Psalm 192 in your hymnal. We will sing the first and fourth verses. Okay, Carol.
Thy channel be.
a channel of blessing, that out from our lives, Jesus will shine. Give us a good week. None of us know what lies ahead, but we, by faith, put our faith and trust and hope in you. Thank you for the opportunity to worship. We go forth the better to serve. In your holy name we pray. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. God bless you.